church is one foundation, is Jesus Christ her Lord. She is his new creation by water and the word. From him he came and sought her.
Our Father, we ask your blessings upon this congregation. We pray, Father, that you would help us to grow in knowledge. Help us to grow in love toward you and toward one another. We pray that you would help us to grow in number as well. Give us opportunities, we pray, to share your good news in our individual lives. And we pray, Father, that you would open up the hearts of those in the community to want to know more about you. Please, Father, we ask you to listen to our prayer because we pray it through Jesus our Savior. Amen. All right, so we kind of started this last week as we were talking about someone who was apparently going around and he was casting out demons and so forth, and he was doing it in the name of Jesus, but he wasn't among the disciples that were following Jesus. And so John hears about this, and what's John's, the apostle's, response to all this? Anybody remember?
What? As to who Jesus was?
No, in this particular case, when he found out that there was someone who was casting out demons and so forth, and that he wasn't following along with them. They were opposed to it. What's this guy doing? He's not one of us. Jesus, shouldn't we tell him to stop it? And Jesus said, no, he said, don't stop it. He who is not against us is for us. What did he mean by that? Yeah. Now, I think it's worthwhile kind of thinking about that response and thinking about what it is that Jesus is getting at here, because, I don't know, in our own lives, will we not find people who will claim to love Jesus, but who, as far as we know, are not members of the Lord's church? So exactly how does this end up falling out? Because on the one hand, you've got the Apostle Paul saying stuff like, if someone should preach to you a gospel that is different than what I've preached to you, what is to be his fate?
Accursed.
Anathema on that guy. And yet, on the other hand, we've got Jesus saying, well, if he's not against us, he's for us. So how do we weigh that out? How do we end up working some of that stuff out? Are there any indications that this particular guy was doing anything that was actually either representing Jesus inappropriately or teaching something against Jesus at all? No, we don't get any kind of indication at all like that. And I think that's worth thinking about, because the problem that we might have with the denominational world is that sometimes they are misrepresenting Jesus and misrepresenting the stuff that he has taught, or the kind of life that he lived, or the kind of things we can read in Scripture overall. Yes, sir?
We have an approach to this in Acts 20, where Paul met about 12 disciples that were teaching about Christ, but they were only teaching the baptism of John, because basically that's all they knew.
Right.
And we see Paul's approach to them was not one of scolding or condemning. He led them in to a discussion by asking him a logical question. Did you receive the Holy Spirit when you were baptized?
Mm-hmm. And that led to a discussion with regard to their own salvation and so forth.
People have a tendency to use the scripture as a club ra- rather than as a inducement to come learn and follow Jesus.
Yeah, I think you're right. Now, what if, for example, what if we were to run into someone across a group that called themselves the household of God, and they believe the same sorts of things that we believe? How should we deal with people like that? Should we wag our finger at them and say,
"Hopefully we are the household of God"?
Well, that's right. That's right. Which kind of goes to, I think I've told the story a couple of times, but I'll tell it again for the sake of illustration. But after World War II, a lot of missionaries went to Europe, and some of those missionaries went to Spain, and some of those Spaniard missionaries ran across a fellow by the name of Juan Monroy, who was kind of leading a group of smaller churches, and they were all doing things the way that we do them. They were having the Lord's Supper on the first day of the week. They were singing without instrumentation. They believed in baptism, and so on and so forth. What do you suppose those missionaries did? Did they wag their finger at them and say, no, you all need to be baptized again by someone from the Churches of Christ and become a part of the Churches of Christ? Is that what they did?
No.
It is not. And I think that was the appropriate thing to do. Why? Well, because God had already added them to the church. Is the household of God a legitimate scriptural name for people that meet together?
Yeah.
As Christians? Yeah, it is. We are told that we're the household of God. So it's something that we probably need to give more careful thought to, because there are some lines of brotherhood that we need to understand and recognize, that despite the fact that they may not have been baptized in a building that had the Church of Christ as a sign on the outside, if they were doing it for the right reasons, if they are believing and practicing the very same sorts of things that we do, what do we know about them?
I say they're brothers in Christ.
They're brothers in Christ. That's who they are. And for us to say something along the line of, well, they weren't baptized by, and I hate this term, but I'm going to go ahead and use it, a Church of Christ preacher, is just not a good biblical sound thing to do. Simply because of the fact that, well, I don't know, you ever thought about going backwards in time a little bit? Of course, it was Alexander Campbell and Martin W. Stone that were kind of responsible for getting the Restoration Movement off the ground in the early 1800s. And initially, anybody know what Alexander Campbell was religiously?
He's Presbyterian.
Yeah. So he came over from Scotland and began preaching and began to think about this notion of undenominational Christianity and that kind of thing, and eventually came to the conclusion that he had not been baptized in the appropriate way, so he decided to get baptized. Who do you suppose baptized him? You know, I really don't know. And it doesn't really matter in the long haul. He was doing it for the right reasons, whoever it was. It might have been a Baptist for all I know. But if he was doing it for the appropriate reasons, is God going to honor that?
Mm-hmm. I have a friend, he's recently gone, but he lived in Searcy, Arkansas, and the government of China has a contract with Harding College and a lot of colleges in this country to educate some of their people, mm-hmm. their master's and doctor's degrees. So they'll send them over to Searcy for a year or so. Mm-hmm. Well, this brother took as his challenge to meet with these students and invite them in his home and so forth, and of course teach them the gospel. And then I met several of them because the ones he converted, he took back to San Francisco, and when they'd come through Arizona, they'd stop and spend the night with us. They would only send, if it's a married couple, only one could come. The other one had to stay in China, you know. But they could come over and visit. And there was a fairly high-ranking communist official. He was a medical doctor. In fact, I think he headed up a large hospital in wherever he was. But he was high-ranking in the communist structure.
Mm-hmm.
Paul taught him the gospel. He didn't convert him while he was here, but when he went back home, they continued their study. I've been at Paul's when he'd get up at like 3 o'clock in the morning to call to China at a whatever hour, decent hour it was over there. The person was converted. He wanted to be baptized, and the question was, who is here that can baptize me?
Mm-hmm.
And they wrestled with that for a long time, and I'm not really sure how they resolved it, but he did was baptized, and of course I lost track with him when I lost my brother, but technically, I think you could go out and get a man on the street to baptize you if he's baptizing you for the right reason.
Yes.
There are those that teach that a certain type of individual must baptize you, but there is no scripture to support that.
No, and you know, there's even those that sometimes will, I've heard them say, you know, if it's not done in a Church of Christ building, and again, I hate that phrase, in a Church of Christ building, it's not necessarily legitimate.
Yeah.
Which is not necessarily so, because, you know, I don't know, there's, it isn't, what does God care about? He cares about
the heart.
My heart. That's what he cares about. And when it comes down to because the guy that I might have chosen to baptize me, let's be honest about it, it could be, people all the time look really good on the outside, but maybe they're more corrupt on the inside. Maybe they're just doing it for pay. Maybe they're just, well, I don't know, whatever. But I've chosen him to baptize me, and so now he's baptizing me. Maybe his motives aren't necessarily completely pure. Maybe he believes in baptism. Maybe he doesn't. So is my legitimacy of salvation dependent upon his heart or upon my heart?
Our salvation depends only upon Jesus. If it depends on the person that baptizes, we're in trouble.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's right. That's right. Yes, sir.
I think his method, as long as he's doing it in the purpose, the way the Bible points it out, mm-hmm. he's doing it correctly, I don't think it could have any significance on him, but it could have significance on you, the one that believes. Because if you don't believe that, then it's in vain.
Yeah.
So you have to, you know, if you're doing it for the purpose and the intent of the heart, the way Christ, plan of salvation, mm-hmm. then you won't be in error.
Yeah. So, I don't know, I think it's worthwhile thinking about those sorts of things sometimes, not because I want for us to, as it were, just open up the floodgates to anybody that wants to call themselves a Christian, but instead to say that we need to be probably careful about wagging our fingers too quickly sometimes, instead to ask the pertinent questions with regard to salvation. Were you baptized for the right reasons? And tell me what those reasons were. Why did you decide to do it? And those sorts of things. Those sorts of things make a difference. As I'm looking at the next question up here, what if they call themselves the temple of God and insist on wine for communion, kneeling for prayer, and women wearing head coverings? Are they brethren?
Of course.
Yeah. Yes, ma'am.
Well, I've always wondered about the progression of growth is with people who were baptized for the right reasons, but might not be worshiping with the Church of Christ or anything called by the biblical name. You know, what does God think about the fact that they're Christians, given that they're Christians, but they're worshiping differently? Because everybody grows and learns things along, especially new Christians. Young new Christians have, you know, a whole lifetime of learning ahead of them. So at what stage in their progress is considered savable?
All until you got to savable. I'm not sure where you're aiming at, but
that's what I was aiming.
But you know, I think I know where you were going. Tell me if I'm wrong, but an example of this possibly might be with regard to folks that are in the Christian church, at least the way it used to be. The reason I say the way it used to be is because I know that there's a Christian church in Manchester, New Hampshire, that used to, years ago, be actually pretty close to the truth, except for the instrument. But these days, it's become kind of a New England version of a megachurch, which isn't a megachurch like around here, but, you know, pretty big bunch of folks meeting there. And they don't insist on baptism anymore, or anything along that line. But the point being is that you know, we've had to sort of struggle a little bit. I actually had one of the Christian church preachers talk with me one time about, I think what he was wanting to do is he was kind of feeling us out to see whether or not we might be interested in merging with them and so forth. And he asked me, so what do you consider us to be? And I told him, well, I think we consider you to be brethren in error. Which I do, because I think they are teaching error, but they were baptized for the right reason. What they need to do is they need to repent of the error. But are those people saved? I'm going to let God be the judge on that.
I'm just going to say, I'm glad I don't have to decide that.
I am too. I mean, my thoughts on it basically is that people who have recently, or maybe even for a moderate amount of time, were if they were baptized for the appropriate reasons, and they became a member of the local Christian church, what do they know about what the Bible teaches about instrumental music? Virtually nothing. They're not going to know anything. They would be worshiping with their whole heart, one would hope, but doing it in a way that God says is inappropriate. The problem is that the Greek, or actually the translations, aren't as clear as they could be and should be. So how would they know? For them, and again, I'm not the judge, for them, I would hold out some hope, because they're doing the best that they can based on what they know. They're not trying to be disobedient. They're not trying to be doing the wrong thing. They're doing their best to try to obey the Lord. Now, the leaders who ought to know what the Greek says, who ought to know what the translations are hiding, I don't hold as much hope out for them. I'm going to let God be the judge on those things. But I don't hold as much hope out for them. I don't know if that touches on what you were asking.
Yes, it does. And what I was going to follow up with is that for lack of a better term, I'll say the ultra-conservative Church of Christ thinks the same thing about us. Because of the way we spend their money, basically.
Mm-hmm.
The autonomy of the church. That's what they think about us, because that's what my relatives tell me. Well, I know you're doing the best you can, but it's in error.
Yeah.
So there's that old issue.
Sometimes people have to ultimately end up agreeing to disagree, not because this is my opinion, that's just your opinion, but we need to make sure that we're backed up on what the scripture actually says, which is crucially important. There are things that, kind of getting back to that top question on the slide back here. Calling yourself the temple of God, is that legit? That's legit. Scripture says so. Is drinking wine for communion okay?
It is.
It is, because that's probably what they did most of the time in the first, second, third, fourth centuries and more. Is kneeling for prayer okay? Sure.
It's okay, but telling me that I can't pray unless I kneel might be something else.
Some of us can't do it anymore. Not easily, anyway. Insisting that women wear head coverings. You know, those are all things that are kind of matters of opinion. I would say there's a number of different postures for prayer, aren't there? There's standing, there's falling flat on your face, there's kneeling, there's lifting your hands up. There's all kinds of postures for prayer. driving a car. Lots of different things that we can do. And if it happens to be that one is living in a culture in which head coverings are meaningful, then I would say you probably should. That women need to wear them. But it kind of depends on the culture. I think if you were going to a Middle Eastern country and you were worshiping with the saints, do Middle Eastern cultures have the tendency to think that head coverings for women are important? They do. Yang, you've been very patient. Thank you for waiting.
I was going to say about what my sister was talking about being a conservative Christian. Okay, that might be good, but I think it can go back to Romans when Paul was saying you can use your conscience to do what is good and bad. However, that is not where we are in now. Christ is here. He's dead. He's giving us the instructions. We have to follow the instructions he has given to us. So it goes down to when Paul went to Corinth, they had these consecrated Christians that who have been baptized with John. However, they were re-baptized to know the right thing in Christ. Mm-hmm. So being a Christian in Christ and being a conscience and doing what your conscience is, it's not right. You have to follow just as you were saying, go by the guidance of the Bible.
Yeah. 1 Corinthians is also, as well as Romans chapter 13 and following, all give us some instructions on having tolerance for people's traditions and opinions. And I think that's useful to know, because we're all going to have some quirks, I suppose. We just need to make sure that our quirks don't violate Scripture. And if they do, then we need to change that. But we just need to know and understand that there are times whenever we do need to be tolerant about some things. Now, on the other hand, as the second question up here is talking about, how does this apply to a group that we meet who don't teach about the need and biblical reason for baptism? Are they brethren? The answer would be no. They're not. They've not been born again. They have not been obedient to what the Scripture very clearly talks about. They may be Christians, or they're not Christians, but they may call themselves Christians, I guess is what I'm trying to say. But they're not brethren. And so we do need to have this distinction in our minds then clearly about those things which are tradition and opinion versus things that are doctrinal. Things that are part of the teachings of Scripture, there can be no compromise. When it comes to matters of opinion, we need to show tolerance and patience toward each other, because that's where real unity comes from. We're going to be, well, I don't know, it's a little bit like a marriage or on a larger scale a family, okay? We all need to kind of be on the same, some sort of same page, but realizing that within a family or within a marriage there may be some difference of opinion on occasion on some stuff, but we still need to find ways to get along. Yes, sir?
I think that's why the Bible continues to study, show yourself approved of working, you know, be able to rightly divide the word of the truth. Because sometimes, you know, we do have opinions, but the opinion that matters more is what the book says.
That's right.
Because opinion is not going to get us into heaven. We may have our differences of how we understand it, but will we come to the same conclusion of what that Bible says?
Questions or thoughts about that? You do understand, I'm not talking about compromising with the world or denominationalism. But we do need to be sure that we're not rejecting someone surely because they're not in our circles. Jim?
You know, the little problems that arise or can arise in some places that we would never think about. I was talking with a missionary, can't even remember who it was now, but he had met and had received some communications from Christians in a very, very isolated part. I believe it was South America. And they were talking about the Lord's Supper.
Mm-hmm.
And they could not, where they were, obtain fruit of the vine. And they could make the bread themselves, the unleavened bread. And so they said, since we can't find fruit of the vine, we've been using water. And his advice to them, don't change God's word, you know. Use what, you know, the bread and, you know, let people know if we had fruit of the vine, we would be drinking it as representing the blood of Christ.
Right.
But don't substitute water or tea or coffee or anything else, because that would be a violation.
Yeah, and part of the reason it is useful thinking through some of these things is for that very reason.
Yeah.
Sometimes we do run across things that are kind of difficult to know what to do. I think if I were in a position like that, I would be somehow or the other communicating with Amazon to deliver me a whole bunch of bottles of drop it in by helicopter or something.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, getting back to that point about the wine, I know what the scriptures, talks about wine, but, that we use grape juice, but I think in a way, I wouldn't say substitute, but in a way that some, it would be a hinder to them, because of some people may revert back to alcoholism or something.
True.
Something you can come and get drunk on.
Right.
So, you don't want to cause that person to stumble. So, I think out of trying to keep a Christian straight and narrow, we want to try not to entice them to do things outside of what we want to do, so we don't want to put it on him.
Sure. Exactly. Well, in the last 5 minutes that we've got here, let's skip on down to verse 51. It says, when the days were approaching for his ascension, he was determined to go to Jerusalem, and he sent messengers on ahead of him, and they went and entered a village of the Samaritans to make arrangements for him. But they did not receive him, because he was traveling toward Jerusalem. When his disciples James and John saw this, they said, Lord, do you want us to command fire to come down from heaven and consume them? But he turned and rebuked them and said, you do not know what kind of spirit you're of. For the Son of Man did not come to destroy men's lives, but to save them. And he went on to another village. So, Jesus is on his way to Jerusalem. And he is passing through Samaria, which, by the way, was a little unusual side. Why? Anybody know or remember? Why would it be unusual for Jesus, as he's going from the Galilee region, going down to Jerusalem, why would it be unusual for him to be passing through Samaria, which was between the two of them? The Jews disliked the Samaritans so bad, they had the tendency to cross the Jordan River over to the east side of the Jordan, go south, cross the Jordan again.
Take the long way around rather than go through.
Yeah, because they just did not like the Samaritans. Jesus, on the other hand, didn't have a problem with it. He went ahead and went through Jerusalem. In this particular situation, though, as he's passing through Samaria, he sends some disciples ahead. Why do you suppose they needed to send someone ahead? Well, yes, they get there first. Okay. But to make arrangements, and the likelihood is, can you imagine walking with a gaggle of disciples behind you? That's got to be slow, okay? If I'm walking by myself, man, I'm going, But if I've got other people I've got to keep up with, or they have to keep up with me, and people are asking questions of you all the time, don't you suppose that was what was happening with Jesus all the time? Always getting questions asked of him all the time. You go a little bit slower, okay?
So he's trying to even stop and drive a point home.
Exactly. So he sends some guys ahead to see if there is some room in the inn, as it were. And doubtlessly, the innkeeper and some of the folks that were there in that town decided to ask him, so, where are you going? And the disciple said, Jerusalem. Oh. So you're going to Jerusalem for Passover? Well, yeah. We don't serve your kind here. Why? Why would they turn down perfectly good money? Because they were simply going to Jerusalem for Passover.
Does it have something to do with the fact that Samaria was the original place for worship?
Actually, it's kind of the other way around. If you take a look, turn over there. Well, mark where we are. I don't want to go over time if I can help it. But take a look at John chapter 4. Notice a couple of details here with me. Jesus meets a Samaritan woman, right? And one of the questions that she asks is,
why are you, a Jewish man, speaking to be a Samaritan.
Well, that's right. But look down to verse 19 specifically. The woman said to him, "Sir, I perceive that you're a prophet. Our fathers worshipped in this mountain." Which mountain is she talking about? The mountain of Samaria. That's what she, because that's where the temple for the Samaritans was. It was in Samaria. Our fathers worshipped in this mountain. And you people, that is say you Jews, say that in Jerusalem is the place where men ought to worship. Now, you might expect that Jesus might be equivocating here. But listen to what he has to say. "Woman, believe me, an hour is coming when neither in this mountain, Samaria, nor in Jerusalem will you worship the Father. You worship what you do not know. We, Jews, worship what we know, for salvation is from" who? The Jews. "But an hour is coming, and now is, when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth. For such people, the Father seeks to be his worshipers. God is spirit, and those that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth." So the bottom line is that they were objecting because probably there were people, the innkeeper was rejecting Jesus, probably because there were people that were going to Samaria to celebrate Passover. Because the Samaritans' religion and the Jewish religions were not that far off. They all came from, all their stuff, their religion came from the Torah, which is the law of Moses. Now, the Samaritan Torah was a little different from the Jewish Torah because they had to tweak a few things to make their religion fit their race, as it were. But the bottom line is that there was great resentment, and there was a great question. Which is the appropriate place to worship, Samaria or Jerusalem? Oh, you're saying it's Jerusalem. We don't serve your kind here. Well, when this gets back to, the messengers come back to Jesus and say, "Well, we tried, but, you know, they found out that we're going to Jerusalem for Passover, and so they wouldn't serve us." Well, what did James and John think? "Those dirty, rotten Samaritans, let's pray that God brings down fire and consumes them because they have rejected the Messiah." Oh, they were full of righteous indignation, right? They were just full of righteous indignation. But Jesus ends up kind of wagging his finger at him and saying, "What? You don't know what spirit you're of. I came here for the purpose of doing what?" What does he say here? Saving people, not destroying them. We're just going to move on. That's what we're going to do. Yes. We'll show you.
That's the difference.
Yeah, it really is. So. All right. Well, that brings us down to the final part of chapter 9. Chapter 9 has been rather lengthy, hasn't it? I think we've been at like about 6 weeks or more. It's been a long time. But we're finally going to be at the very last section next week. We're talking to three would-be disciples. And hopefully we'll actually make it in chapter 10 next time. So. If you're visiting with us online, we're grateful for your presence. We hope that you'll stick around for a few more minutes because we're going to be worshiping God in the public assembly in just a few minutes, and we'd love to have you join us. Thanks for all your good questions.
The church is one family.